No, I don't actually need that, right, Curtis? Praise God. So let me just start with this before I dismiss the kids, because I got the greatest surprise this morning. My son and daughter-in-law and their family walked in, and I was so excited because I love them. More importantly, they brought my grandkids, who I really love.
Thanks, buddy.
So thanks for coming. You made me really happy. I just love my grandkids so much, so thankful for them. So I am going to dismiss the kids now. So Jim's going to take the junior hires out there. Jane will take the ones below that. There you go. 3 years to kindergarten in the classroom over here. First to fifth with Jane. Sixth to eighth in the arc with Jim. Go ahead and line up and you can go. Go, therefore. I love all of you, but I really love my... JoJo, I love you. Zeke, I love you. Abel. Hi, buddy. I love you. Hi, buddy. That's my grandson, Abel. Man, he brings joy to my heart. We're going to continue with the Gospel of Matthew. Doug and I have been kind of walking through the Gospel of Matthew. And today we are going to talk about the sending out of the 12 apostles. And I want to share some things on that. So how many of you noticed we did not take an offering today? Did you notice that? How many go, oh no, they didn't take offering. We do that? Because I know a lot of you really want to give, but we're actually going to do that at the end. Right at the end, you'll have an opportunity to give. And so, yeah, Roman, you can go out to the ark. There you go. Good. So, I have a lot of questions about this. Chapter 10, Gospel of Matthew. And there are some, this event is also recorded in the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of Mark. It's not in the Gospel of John. And there are some parallels. Now, I will tell you, from my understanding, that when Jesus sends the apostles out, not long after that is when he feeds the 5,000. And that's significant for a lot of reasons, which I don't have time to go into today. But it's pretty incredible. And then after he feeds the 5,000, there's a week or two more, and that's when he sends the 72 disciples out. And I'm going to relate back to that. That's found, he sends the apostles out. We find that recorded in Luke, the 9th chapter. He sends the 72 out in Luke, the 10th chapter. And in Mark, also, it's recorded the sending out of the 12 apostles. So, this is a little bit confusing to me. Because if I were to do what Jesus did, I would have done it in a different order, which is good. Amen? So, here's where we're going with this, and at the end, you'll understand even more. In chapter 10 of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus sends the apostles. He promises the apostles. And he calls the apostles. So I will give you some other scriptures because I do believe that we too are sent, promised, and called. You'll understand more as we go through. So we find that Jesus called the 12 disciples and gave them authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every kind of sickness. And then he gives the names of all the apostles, which we've already gone through a couple weeks ago. And Jesus then gives them really specific instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or into the town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. And as you go, preach this message. The kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Now, please understand with me. I know he's talking specifically to the apostles there. He's not really at that point talking to us. I will tell you, scripture is consistent after that, that we too have the same call. We are sent. One mistake I think we make sometimes is we think, well, he told them to raise the dead, heal the sick, cure leprosy. Now, I have prayed for people for healing, but I got to tell you, Jesus has not told me yet to go raise somebody from the dead. Hadn't happened. It might. I'm not saying it couldn't, but I'm just telling you, he hasn't told me that. And so some people get mixed up. And they start thinking, well, he said that the apostles, now I'm going to go do this. And so then they start teaching that. Anybody heard people teach that stuff? Be careful what you hear people say. Make sure it's consistent with scripture. And you'll see me, I'm going to back up what I say, not only with this scripture, but with other scriptures. Now, the first thing he does is he sends the apostles. Jesus sent them, then, and Jesus sent people throughout his ministry. Now, when he sends them, he says, go to these specific people. Go to the Jewish people. I'm not sending you to the Gentiles right now, although later we know they're sent to the Gentiles. You know who Gentiles are? So if you're not Jewish here, you're a Gentile. Okay, that's us. So we'll see later where that happens, where Jesus sends out all of us. So Jesus is still sending believers today. We know he sent the apostles. They went and did what he says. Oh, I want to, let me just say this real quick. This is in, it doesn't say this here, but in the instance in Luke where he sends out the 72, the 72 come back and tell Jesus, oh man, you see what happened? We were raising the dead. We were kicking it, man. We were really doing awesome. Look at all we did. Look at what we did, Jesus. We raised the dead. We healed the sick. We cleansed the leper. We did all this. Jesus says, calm down. He didn't really say that there, but I'm telling you, that's what he's saying to him. Calm down. You know, I saw Satan falling like lightning from the sky. But don't rejoice in this. Hear what he says. Rejoice that your names are written in the Lamb's book of life. As much as I've seen, had the opportunity to see Jesus do in my life, I actually have gotten to pray for people who got healed. I've also prayed for people who didn't get healed. Well, they got healed eternally. Jesus took them. Now, I don't understand why sometimes yes, sometimes no. All I can tell you is I've gotten to see Jesus do a lot of things. But I can tell you the longer I live, the more I see, I am thankful that Jesus has called Mike Nichols and put his name in the Lamb's Book of Life. If you have believed that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, if you believe that in your heart and you believe God raised him from the dead, you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's greater. That's greater than raising the dead. That's greater. That's greater. Wow. I'm going to get excited in a minute. So Jesus is still sending believers today. 1 Peter, the 3rd chapter. But in your heart, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to answer, give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. but do it with gentleness and respect. In 2 Corinthians, we see that we are therefore Christ ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. In Ephesians, the second chapter, we see we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. And in Romans, the 10th chapter, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they have not believed? How can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? That's us, folks. And how can they preach unless they're sent? We're going to talk about what it means to be sent. But I heard that scripture so many times, so people would give money to missionaries. That's not what he's saying. He's saying God's going to send you. Now, that doesn't mean we're going off into the Africa. When I was a young guy in Bible college, I actually had somebody give me this word. I was going to Africa. I said, oh, no, baby. That's not my calling. I had a different calling. So we always think of sent, being sent way out there. We're sent right here in Wilsonville, Oregon. We're sent right where you're at in Canby, Oregon. We are sent to the people that God has given us to. In Acts, it says this, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. But it starts right here. Church, it starts here. Listen, you're sent by God. Not only is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you're sent by God. Say amen. Matthew 28, which we'll talk about in a couple, 3 weeks sometime. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, here's something you really need to know. I don't have time to spend on this. If you have received Jesus into your life, if you've done that, if you believed on Jesus, he's given you gifts. He has equipped you to do what he wants you to go do. He has equipped every single one of you to reach those he's called you to. He hasn't withdrawn. He hasn't failed in anything. Now, you have been equipped. If you look in Romans, the 12th chapter, we have different gifts according to the grace given us. If your gift's prophesying, use it in the proportion to his faith. If it's serving, let him serve. If it's teaching, let him teach. If it's encouraging, let him encourage. If it's contributing to the needs of others or giving, let him do it generously. If it's leadership, let him govern diligently. If it's mercy, let him show cheerfully. And in Matthew, the 8th verse, 10:8, we see, freely you have received, freely give. Now here's what I'm sharing with you. So every morning, this is one of my prayers. I have a whole kind of a thing that I do. But every morning I say, Lord, I just acknowledge, I humble myself before you. I deny myself and I take up my cross and I want to hear your voice and follow you every day. And I really mean that from my heart. So one of the gifts I know God's given me is the gift of encouragement. I can't help it. Everybody thinks some people think I'm loud and obnoxious. I'm just telling you, I can't help it. I love Jesus so much. I love you so much. I want to encourage you in the Lord. I want to build you up. I want to help you. But I'm not the only gift. We all have gifts that God's given us so he can use them to expand his kingdom, so he can use them to encourage one another. That's why it's so great to see so many of you here today. Man, we get to be with one another. We get to encourage each other. Secondly, we're sent. Secondly, we're promised. We're promised. Jesus promises the disciples something here, or apostles. He also promises the disciples. Now, I want you to hear the promise, because it is awesome. I want you to hear the promise of Jesus to these folks. This is really good. Now, watch. The apostles, he says this. Be on your guard against men. They will hand you over to local councils and flog you in their synagogues. On my account, you'll be brought before governors, kings, and witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, don't worry about what to do or say. At that time, I'll give you what you need to say. For it will not be speaking, but you will not be speaking, but the Spirit, your Father, from your Father, is speaking through you. So if you look at the list, here's his promise. He sent him. I'm going to send you. Folks, he's sending us. He's sending us. Here's the promise. You're going to be hated. You're going to be persecuted. People are going to abuse you and put you down and hate you on my account. That's the promise. Yeah, let's go. We get so caught up. Oh, God's going to bless me because I'm going out. Oh, God. Yes, he does. Folks, he does. He does heal. He does bless. He does encourage. He does all that. But folks, I want you to know the call of God. When we are sent from God, everybody's looking. I'm not going to call out any preachers, but I will tell you there's a lot of preaching going on there about if you just accept Jesus and your life will be hunky-dory. If you accept Jesus and you're sent by him, you're going to endure persecution. You're going to endure times in your life that are not very fun. And when you obey Christ Jesus, when you do what he wants you to do, it's not going to be easy. Please, please. You can test me out. You can look in Scripture and see if I'm lying to you right now. And I'm not. Look at Scripture. What does Scripture say? In Hebrews, the 11th chapter, one of my favorites. The whole chapter goes on about how all these great men and women of faith are just conquering. God blesses them, and they are just heroes. And verse 35, chapter 11, Hebrews says, women received back their dead, raised to life again. Others were tortured and refused to be released so that they might gain a better resurrection. Some faced jeers, flogging, while others chained and put in prison. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskin and goatskin, destitute, persecuted, mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in streets and mountains and in caves and holes in the ground. These are all commended for their faith. Yet none of them received what they had been promised. God had planned something far better for them and for us. In the first verse in chapter 12 of Hebrews says this. I just love this. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let's throw off every encumbrance and the sin that so easily entangles us. And let's run with endurance the race set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the pain and the suffering of the cross. People who are sent are going to endure persecution. We have this teaching in America that just says, oh, everything will be you. If you're a Christian, you've got a comfortable life. Sorry, serving and being sent by Jesus is not comfortable. It's not convenient. His call is not based on our time schedule. Like or dislike, serving Jesus and walking with him will at some point cost you. There is a price we all pay to follow Jesus with all of our heart. There's a price. Some of you have paid that price. So when we make decisions that we know are godly, it'll cost us. Please stop thinking that you've gotten a raw deal. Please know that Jesus hasn't left you. Please know that he's with you always, even to the end of the world. I was amazed that my son and daughter-in-law came. You're one of my illustrations. I'm sorry, I never use you for illustrations. I probably. My grandson, Abel, has some handicaps. I don't know if I'm going to get through this. When my daughter-in-law was pregnant with Abel, the doctors told him, hey, he's got a lot of problems. He's got some handicaps. You should probably get an abortion. That's what the doctors told him. He's not going to be able to do anything. You should just go get an abortion. I'm not surprised at what they said to the doctors. They said, nope, that's not happening. We're going to trust God. And there was prayers prayed all over the place. God, heal Abel. God, do this. God, do a miracle. And we didn't see that happen necessarily, except this. I don't know how many of you have been around Abel, but that kid will fill your heart with joy. There's not a kid I've met that is so full of life, so full of, I believe, of the Lord. He affects everybody he's around. He comes to preschool here, and all the kids just love him. He has a smile that's as infectious as can be. God, when he sends us and we do what he wants us to do, it is not going to be easy many times. We're going to face. Now, I got to tell you, I don't know how you do it. Either one of you. But they take care of that little boy. He averages at least 2 appointments or more a week, something like that. But they just love that boy. And man, when I see him, I just light up. I got to be careful because I love him so much. I love all my grandkids, but sometimes I neglect my other ones because I love to see him. When you're sent by Jesus and you do what he wants you to do, it'll cost you. Now, does God still bless us? Sure. Has he forgotten us? No. So here was the confusing thing to me. We're sent. We're promised. So I want you to remember that next time you think about God's promises. God promises a lot of good things too. Don't get me wrong. We have eternal life waiting for us, everybody who believes on Jesus. And that in and of itself is incredible. I can't imagine what heaven's going to be like. My mama is already there. My grandma's already there. I can't imagine what heaven's going to be like, but it's going to be beyond my comprehension and beyond your comprehension. But not only in that life, but in this life, God still blesses us. God provides for us. God, we get to see God do great things like we heard Jane talk about. Our brother Robert was up here earlier, and I was so proud of him. Guys, I don't know, has it been a year since you got baptized, brother? What's that? Oh, so, guys, Robert just started walking with the Lord really about a year ago. Am I wrong? Got baptized here, and here he is, up sharing about the life of Jesus. How many know he did an awesome job? That stuff gets my juices going, baby. Let's go. So there's blessing here too. But if we think that because I'm a believer, I'm going to escape any hardship, please get that out of your head. That's not the truth. Here's the last thing, and this is what confused me. We're called. We're called. Called to be disciples. And if you look, Matthew 10, 37. Anyone who loves his father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. This is what Jesus said. Anyone who loves his son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And anyone who does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. And whoever finds his life will lose it. And whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Jesus said in John, the 14th chapter, if you love me, you'll obey what I command. And in Luke, it says, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. Whoever wants to lose his life will save it. What good is it if a man gains a whole world and yet loses his own soul? Now, here's what confuses me. Maybe you can help me with this. Because I actually asked the Lord this question. Because it seems to me, this is what seems to me, that he would call us to be disciples. Now, let me just explain what he just said. He's not telling you to go hate your husband, ladies. No, not what he's saying. He's not telling you, husbands, to go hate your wives. Parents, it's not like we could do it anyway. Every once in a while, we want to slap our kids on the head. But it's not like he's telling you to hate your children. He's not. Not telling you to hate your mom and dad. What he's saying is, he needs to be first. 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 Before my wife, Jesus is first. I love my wife so much, you can't even believe it. And I'm so thankful she's my wife. But I love Jesus first. I love my son. I love my grandkids. I love my daughter. I love my family. But Jesus is first. He's saying he needs to be the absolute priority. Because if he's not, then you won't do what he said to do. When Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments, he's not saying, you better love me. You better get with it. Love me so you can keep my commandments. No, this is what he's saying. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. You will. If I love Jesus more than anything else, I'm going to keep his commandments to the best of my ability. If I love Jesus first, before my wife, before anything, if I do that, then I'm his disciple. So he's not saying you got to hate. That would be inconsistent with who he is. He's saying he's got to be first. He's got to be first, folks. First. His call. If we want to be sent, we won't even listen to him unless he's first. If we want to walk in his promises, we got to have him first. Jesus, if he's not the absolute number one love of our life, priority in our life, we will not let him send us. We will not walk in his promise. That's a fact. So in just a minute, my friend Lisa has helped me. In just a minute, we'll start those. Jesus is sending you, folks. I don't know what he's sending to you, sending you to. I don't know what he is telling you to where he's telling you to go. It may be just right here, and that's okay. So I've asked Lisa to make a slide, and each slide will show about 5 seconds of every ministry that we're involved here at Valley Christian Church. Why am I doing this? I'm not doing an advertisement for VCC. Don't need to do that. But I'm putting it up there because Jesus may be calling you to be involved in one of those. One thing I know is Jesus is not calling us just to stay idly by. Jesus is sending us. He's sending you. He's sending me. And so, you can look out, they'll be on about 5 seconds. These are the ministers from VCC. So as you look at that, I just want you to know that Jesus has given us so many opportunities to be involved somewhere, to Vacation Bible School. Wow, yeah, that's awesome. I want you to see that for such a small church, God has opened up doors of ministry for us in so many avenues and in so many ways. It is incredible. Yeah. So I'm asking you right now, as that goes through, I'm asking you to say this. You don't have to do anything I tell you. I am asking you to do what Jesus says. And I want you to say this prayer: Lord, what are you sending me to in these ministries? Is there anything he's sending you to? Is there anything he's calling you to? We need people to help with Sunday school. And you guys have been amazing. You've been incredible. I know many of you are already involved, but is God calling you to more? What's he sending to you to? That's what's important. And so I'm going to ask you right now, right as soon as these slides are done, we're going to pray, and then we're going to leave. Oh, yeah! Praise God. But I was amazed, guys, at how many ministries we have at this little church. Do you see how God has blessed us? The blessing to be involved. The blessing to serve. It's a blessing to obey Christ and be sent. Oh, I like that one. Help out with that. Praise God. That's the last one. I'm not going to pray. You're going to pray. And this is what I'm asking you to ask Jesus. Lord, what are you sending me to? Will you pray and just ask the Lord and open your heart? Now, Lord, I know you're speaking different things, different folks in this church. There's different personalities, different giftings, different talents. But, Lord, we want to hear your voice and follow you. We want to obey you. Thank you, Lord. Send us to what you want us to do. Here we are, Lord. Send us. In the name of Jesus. Amen. So you notice we didn't take offering. You already said, you notice that? This is how we're doing it today. A little bit different. I shook up Doug a little bit on this, but there's a box in the back. It's right in the middle, right by where Doug's standing. If God has spoken to your heart today to give financially, just put it in that box. And as you do, it says unto the Lord. You're given to the Lord. You're given to these ministries you just looked at. 30 slides, I think, we had up there. Give. Give what God's asked you to give. Give by being sent and doing what he wants, and give by financial support. Amen? I'm not Jesus, but I'm sending you. Go. I
living on a